Have you seen the cakes?
Ooh.
Oh my God. Are you kidding? That's amazing. And can you slow-mo video eat one? That's going to be amazing.
Let's let folks in. Yeah.
Oh, whoa.
So welcome to the Sid City Social Club for Friday, November 12th. We're excited that you're here. I'm Mel with SidCity.net, and we have a whole crew of people who are in London for Destination Star Trek, and they're meeting at a pub next to the venue. And we're doing another hybrid meeting like we did in Vegas. So if you were at that one, you kind of know how this works. Today's show requires a lot of extra people to make it work. So big thanks to Rob Moriarty and Colin for organizing and getting the venue and getting everything set up. And also thanks to Nikki, Chris, Eve, Amy, and Robin for their help. We were supposed to have Sid with us today. He has not shown up yet. He emailed me late last night and said that his filming schedule might change. He said there was a big possibility that he wouldn't be able to come because they were moving things around, and he called it maddening. Okay, well, we're going to start things off with our buddy, Pete. Pete Clifford is here in London.
He has no idea that he's going to be chatting to me or anything like that, but yes.
Surprise!
So Pete is here. And, so I asked Pete to come along because he hasn't started yet, but he is going to do some amazing feats of magic. And I have said this before, and you will by the end of the evening believe this, Pete is genuinely one of the best close-up magicians, I would honestly say, in the world. Because if Darren Brown in the UK wants to work with you and David Blaine in America wants to work with you, I think that says something. So, Pete, have you got a trick you could do right now, this second? You can see we've prepared this. Okay, what would you like to...
All right, you can hold the microphone.
Okay, this
is going to be... I'm going to try this. Two elastic bands, and they just link my fingers together like this. So they link together, link my hands together, and they don't come apart then. They don't come through, they don't come off the ends. But if you rub the middle, they just pass through each other. Like this. I'll try that again. Oh! Oh! Can I have a volunteer? Here we go. Perfect.
So I'm going to show, I'll show you one more time what's going to happen. See the link together?
Yes.
Yeah, now if you pull hard, it won't work. Yeah, you can pull hard any direction, nothing. Rub gently in the middle and they pass right through like this.
What the hell?
Let's try one more time. If you point at me like this, both hands.
Okay.
That's good. Which one should I place on your fingers? This one or this one?
This one,
an excellent choice. That is the better of the two. It's so nice to meet a connoisseur, it really is. If you point up in the air for me.
Yes.
And then make two fists, so you trap the elastic band. And if I just turn you on this angle slightly so that people can see there, and I'm going to place this like this, because some people think that I slip it around the end really quickly. Now I can't do that because you won't let me, will you?
True.
We are linked together.
We are.
Forever.
Wow.
It's a beautiful thing. Welcome. And if I let go of my finger on my thumb, it'll fly off. We don't want that to happen. But you can see I really am on that side, yes?
Yes, you are.
Yep, and it won't go around the ends. You won't let it. And I am on that side. I can't go that way. Won't come this way. You won't let it off the ends. But if you watch the middle, it's where it just passes right through.
Oh. There you go.
Sorcery.
Here we go. I'll do one more. While you're there.
This is the microphone, not that. Oh, that's the picture.
It's real
people.
You
are very welcome. Thank you very much. Round of applause. There you are.
So can I go home now?
Yeah, you can go home. Yeah, so Pete, so at Sid and R's wedding, Pete was there. And what was really sweet was you met Django, how many years later? And he was two? When I told you were coming over, he was only two at the time, and he strongly remembered the tricks that Pete had done at the wedding, because he was just so amazed by it. So he did that, and Pete did it on my 50th as well. He did tricks for the
everywhere.
Yeah, Do you mind people asking you questions just generally about things? So Peter's worked with, so if you're in the UK or you might know Darren Brown, anybody here as well. He's worked with Darren Brown. He's worked with David Blaine. Has anybody got a question on Zoom or here that you would like to ask Pete about those situations or what it's like, or just generally questions? Let's see. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Hello. Yes. Oh, it's the same volunteer, everybody. This is like a plant in the audience, but it's really not. So, yes.
When do you find out that you have magic? Like, because I can't believe it's something that you learn. It's something that you have. So when do you find out you could do sorcery?
I don't know how to answer that now. I don't know how to answer that without destroying your wonder. I discovered it when I had a lonely childhood and a pack of cards when I was 12 years old, and I just moved into a new area, so I didn't have any friends, and then the friends that I'd made went to one school and I went to another school, so I lost all those friends again. So it was a period of sort of enforced solitude, which most magicians seem to have in their life, either because they've been in prison or they're just lonely childhoods usually. and I had a pack of cards and just started shuffling cards and learning tricks and entertaining people with that. And it's my wife's a psychologist, and she said that I'd swapped one form of self-stimulation, which was rocking, for another. Which was the pack of cards, he says quickly, feeling Colin staring at me from the side. So, yeah, I was about 12 years old when I discovered that I could fool people or entertain people and create a sense of wonder. I've just sort of done it ever since then. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. Good question.
Actually, I have a question which I've never asked you. When did you decide to switch your focus when you were doing your tricks? Because I've obviously known you for a long time and I've seen a lot of the tricks you've done, but you're very keen at the moment in like using magic to tell a story or to invoke a sense of wonder rather than that thing of a magician being on stage going, aren't I so clever because I know a trick and you don't, that kind of thing, which you hate that, yeah, about magic.
I've never done magic like that. I've always tried to do it as trying to instill a sense of wonder, but also sharing that wonder. I've never wanted to demonstrate and to be seen as special, ironically. I'm more of an introvert, much more of an introvert, so I don't like standing out that much, but at the same time love acting and telling stories and sharing the wonder. So sharing the wonder was a way of still doing the magic and still being on stage in front of people, but at the same time it's not about me, it's about, hey, it's more like, hey, come look at this, come and look at this. This is amazing. This is really surprising. Watch what happens when we rub two elastic bands together. And it's just, oh, look, it's on. So I try and romance the subject that way. And also I always think of the audience as like the final member of the cast that didn't turn up for rehearsals. So they're going to have to improvise. And I'm there improvising with them. So I know roughly what's going to happen for the evening. Or however long, or the moments that I'm with them doing magic. They don't, but I will feed off what they bring to it, so that I try and make it, that way I can make each evening unique. Each evening becomes the story of what happens with that gathering of those people. And then we create something together. Does that answer?
Yeah, no, it totally does. And also, tell people how... Because of that, tell people how David Blaine approached you, because he wanted to work with you. That's the crazy thing.
So I was doing a magic convention as opposed to a Star Trek convention. I was at a magic convention, and the reason that I was there was Darren in this country was the guest of honor, and they wanted to interview him, but he wanted me to interview him. So the organizers of the convention phoned me up and said, oh, look, would you come to the convention and would you interview Darren as the guest of honor? I went, yeah, okay, I'll do that. And then they said, oh, would you also do a talk? Would you do a little talk? I went, I didn't really feel I have anything to say to people, to magicians. And then they said, well, do something on stagecraft or something. And okay. So I did a 20-minute talk on character, stagecraft for magicians, creating a narrative structure from something that doesn't intrinsically have one, walking and talking on stage, all the sort of things that you do as an actor that apply to performing anything. And magic, and I crammed all that. Each one of those could be like a day's workshop, but I crammed it all into 20 minutes. So it was a quite intensive 20 minutes. And David Blaine happened to be in the audience and just came up to me afterwards and said, "Yeah, Peter, I'd like you to come and work with me in the States." And I was like, "Oh yeah, okay, that's fine. Lovely, nice to meet you. Thank you." Thinking it was quite like an actor saying, "Let's do lunch," which in my head means it's really nice to meet you. I really like your work. If we spent time together in the future, that would be lovely, but let's not get our diaries out just yet. But no, because 3 weeks later, I was in New Orleans, sat in a hotel room working with David Blaine. So it was very surreal. But yeah.
And how was that experience for you?
Working with David. It was really interesting. On the plane over, I was terrified because I just thought I've got absolutely nothing to offer this man. He could literally have anyone he wanted to come and do, because it was to work with him and direct his stage show and create a stage show with him. And on the way over, I was thinking, I've got nothing to say. I don't know what to do. I don't know what I'm going to be doing. And then I thought, oh, but this is going to be an opportunity to learn so much. What? How exciting. So I went over thinking, oh, I've been invited, so that's great. That takes a bit of pressure off, and I'm going to learn. I'm going to learn so much. So I went over eager to learn about how to put things together, and having that attitude when I walked into the room with that eagerness to learn was perfect for creating a creative atmosphere, and it spilled over to the other people that were there. I was sort of going, oh, how does this work? What are we doing here? Oh, what can we do with this? How does this work? Where can we go with this? How about if we do this? And I've kept that. Whenever I sort of feel nervous about going into a situation now, I always think, well, I'm going to learn something from here. I can learn something. And that's whatever kind of meeting I'm going into.
Yeah. Has anybody here or on Zoom got a question for me?
Yes, Jenniba is going to ask a question.
You had talked about the fact that magic is at its heart a bit of acting, a lot of acting. And one of the things about it is that it's also sort of in the similar vein to comedic routines, in that you know the punchline way before the audience does. So I'm curious how you, in the relationship that you build with your audience, whether it's one person or a room full or whatever, how you hold yourself in check to wait for them to catch up with you, of like, you guys are gonna be so amazing, you know, like how you have that moment of letting them come along without telling them beforehand.
Well, the draw is I know that them not knowing is the draw, and the longer that they don't know, because with magic, can you hold that for a second? Thank you very much. So with magic, you always start at the same point as the audience. You sort of start generally with a point where you're physically and mentally in the same place, and then you start telling this story where you're going along, oh, here goes the story. But what you're really doing as the magician is you're going up here, you're going this way with your moves or whatever you're doing secretly or whatever spells you're casting, because it's real magic. And whatever spells you're casting in the background as you're telling the narrative, the ways part until you reveal, like whether if you take a coin into your hand and then the coin's vanished, it might have gone before you reveal it. But the longer you can keep and the bigger you can make that gap, when you make the reveal, then the audience's brain has to make that jump to the reality of where you are. So part of the joy of it and the way of keeping it in check is that I know that the further I can push the audience away from the reality, when the reality is revealed, I know that that's going to have a greater sense of wonder for them and a greater impact and a better experience for them. So that's why I do it.
How do you come up with a new magic trick? Do you like build on the work that other magicians have done? And what can you tell us about the magic circle? Like spill all the secrets of the magic circle.
I don't know anything about the magic circle. I'm no longer a member. When I was first interested in magic, I was too young to join. Then when I was old enough, I realized that they didn't let women in. And I thought, that's not right. I'm telling you that there is nothing legally preventing me from spilling most of the secrets, if not all of them. But there are no secrets. It's all real wonder, isn't it? What was the other question? How do I come up with new tricks? That is lots of different ways, lots of different ways. Sometimes it is building on things that people have done before. So sometimes someone will have created an effect that I want to do. And I go, oh, that would be good. Then I find my own way of presenting that trick. So in, much like doing a cover version of a song, but in my own style. Other times I will think, oh, wouldn't it be cool if we could do that? So when I was working with Darren and when I was working with David, I ended up working on the TV show with David as well. So it was like, oh, what would be cool for this person to be able to do? Well, this person, particularly with Darren, with his psychological powers, what would be amazing if someone had those powers? What would be great if they could do? Oh, how about this? How about you phone someone and they pick up the phone and you just make them collapse over the phone? That would be amazing. How are we going to do that? Right. Okay. And then you find ways of thinking about it and find ways of doing that, going off in that direction. So there's the effect. And you want the audience to go along here and then, oh, realize they've gone up there. So how do you get up there without anyone seeing? And the other way of doing it is when I create a theatre show, I tend to work on themes. So the one I'm doing at the moment is that it's called Peter Clifford's Magical Mythologies. And that's it. It was going to go out in 2020, March 2020. I was going to, but the show won't work now. I'm going to have to rewrite it. So the first half is stories that we're aware of, stories that we tell ourselves, literature. So I'm going to do something with the complete works of Shakespeare. I'll do something with words talk about the beginning, middle, and ends of stories. And I've got one trick where I do it three times, do it with the beginning, middle, and end. And then I do the end, the middle, and then the beginning. And then I take the middle out and just do the end and the beginning. And then I do the end and the beginning at the same time. So that I sort of play around with the narrative structure of a trick, but create these different tricks whilst I'm doing it. And then the second half is going to be about stories that we're not aware of, stories that we don't know that we're telling ourselves all the time, the internal narrator that narrates your life, that puts together all the physical impulses and inputs you get from sight and sound and touch and taste and that narrator, and how you can fool that narrator to make them reveal themselves. And so that's the second half. And then I'm going to round it up in some wonderful, wholesome, meaningful way, which is going to be a big, nice rounding up trick at the end, which brings everything together. And I've got absolutely no idea what that is at the moment, but I've got until April to find it.
Oh, we have a Zoom question, I believe.
We do. We're going to go to Una.
Hello, Una. Are you not here this weekend?
No, I can't. I can't make it. But Verity has a question.
What was the first magic trick you ever did?
Great question. Probably that one.
She knows that one.
I can't see. That, there's the camera here.
I need to take your little finger.
Try yourself with your fingers.
Oh, she will. She definitely will. Yep. There you go.
Oh, that's such a lovely reaction. No! Oh, Lord. That's so sweet. That is such a good question, though. That is a really good question. And I have a question, which was because I always remember this when. So you and I went to see one of Darren's shows quite early on. At one point, I turned to you and was like, that was amazing. And I was like, how does he do that? And you went, I have no idea. And that was the thing that absolutely amazed me. There are times when you watch other magicians and you go, I don't know how that is done. You've got ideas, but you don't know.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, Darren and I, when we used to work together, we used to spend a lot of time together, and we used to go to quite extraordinary lengths to try and give each other a magical moment. Because when you're a magician, so to speak, when you're a magician, you tend to lose that because you start to appreciate different things. You start to appreciate skills or particular bits of thinking or particular bits of psychology behind effects. So when you find something that makes you go, oh, wow, that's amazing. That's amazing. I also might have been lying.
Because
that's the other thing. If you tell someone, it's one of the reasons I'm not sure about Fula. So it's the Penn & Teller show. Because if you tell someone that you know how it's done, then there's something to be known, which means it's not magical anymore. So I will often say, yeah, I have no idea. Just to keep that going. No, it's a good thing. But often now, it's rare that I see something that fools me. I love it when I do. I love being fooled. But often now, it's just like, oh, yeah. Oh, very good, very good, very good. Fooled me, got me. Yep, that's nice.
Okay. Any more Zoom questions? Oh, is that a Zoom hand I see?
We've got Tom with his hand up. He's got a very important question, I'm sure.
I have a highly important question. It's a bit of a mean question, sorry. Because I know that you are exceptionally gifted and magical feats come at your fingertips. But is there anything at all ever...
Not so far.
Is there anything
Keep going on that. That's fine.
Is there anything that you've run up against that has stumped you? Yeah, an idea that you've come across that you've gone, I do not know how to connect those dots to make that happen.
Yes.
What was it?
So far. But sometimes then I'll be walking along and just go, oh, I know what that is. My brain will be working on it, or I'll find a way of doing it. I'll find some way of doing something close to it. Sometimes because you want to go for the purest effect possible, and sometimes that isn't possible. You have to compromise in some ways, and it's just how much you can hide the compromise and how much you are willing to compromise. And
I don't want to know what it is, but is there one in the back of your brain that's been there for a while that's just sort of sat there that you keep thinking about?
Yeah.
That's the expression I was looking for.
hopefully, if you come to Bristol on April the 1st, you'll see that I've solved it. But
brilliant. I will be there.
So this is what I wanted to do. So do the thing, just, you know, the moving the coin on your hand, you know, that, rolling the coin.
There we go. At the coin roll, that's just... Can you see that? That's pretty.
Yeah. So they wanted someone who could do that trick with the coin roll, but with the top of a beer bottle cap. So you can imagine if it's between a coin and a beer bottle cap. And because all they wanted to show was the hand just rolling the beer bottle cap in between the fingers. And what happened was he gets the job, And then you find out that of all the people that they interviewed, you were the only person who could physically do that.
Yeah. When I got the job, I just went, well, obviously, if I make it heavier, stick a bit of coin metal in, another coin inside, that then it'll be easier. That'll be fine. But then I got flown out to Lisbon and Portugal to do this. And then I had to do it, and I had to roll it, and then I had to bring it around and come back up to the camera, but with the word crystal. So I had to work out a way of rolling it and bring it up with the word crystal, horizontal, so that everyone could read it. So just boom. Oh, yeah, okay. Blah, blah, blah. That was okay, so I got that. Then I had to do it underneath a big... big reflecting things. My hand was up there and I was down here doing it. Couldn't see. Had to get it so it came up with crystal. Has it come up with crystal? Oh, please. Please. So I was doing that for hours. And then at the end, they said, great. Now can you roll it, bring it up into your hands, and then crush it between your finger and thumb along the line crystal. And it was just like, oh. I just couldn't do it. I was just like, I was underneath this piece of polystyrene crying, just going, please stop. There we go. Yeah. Thank you for reminding me of that.
Yeah, yeah, the tribe, bringing the trauma, yeah.
So I'm curious, because magic is your job. Do you ever do it sort of on the fly or just for fun? Like if you're at a coffee shop and someone discovers you're a magician, do you just do like what you did for us? Just pull out a little trick and just do it? Or is it like it's your work and you just don't want to talk about it?
Yes. It's just both of those. It depends. I've come up here to because I was asked to, and I didn't even know I was doing this. But it was just if people want to see it, I will happily do it wherever. Because I've always done it ever since I was a kid. I've just gone, always had a pack of cards on me. I still always have a pack of cards on me.
Kellas, we have a question from you, I believe.
Actually, I'm asking for Crow because their connection is crappy as usual. Crow's question is it easier to teach a comedian to do magic or easier for someone who knows some magic tricks to learn comedy?
Ooh, that's an ooh, yeah. Good question, Crow. Well done. Yeah.
That's an interesting question. I know a lot of magicians that have used magic as a prop to become stand-up comics. So they haven't been quite brave enough just to step straight out and do stand-up comedy. They've gone out with some tricks and then the tricks have faded away and they've just stand-up comics.
Name names.
Danny Buckler. Would be one for that. But I would say that it's probably easier to teach a comic magic than a magician comedy. It's hard enough to teach most magicians how to perform, let alone do comedy. I'd say. Mm-hmm. I'd say this. Magicians fool themselves into thinking they can perform, I think, because if they think that if someone doesn't know how a trick is done, they've performed it well. When in fact, if they've done a trick and people don't know how it's done, it's just that they've done the moves right. They haven't necessarily performed it. They've followed the instructions to create the wonder, and they followed the spell. They followed the spell. So I think that they can then be fooled by the audience going, "Oh wow, that's amazing!" By thinking the audience is saying, "Oh, you're amazing at performing," when in fact it's nah. That's my experience of it.
Five of one and one of another. Five favourite magicians, one you cannot stand.
Oh! Colin's new game show. It's just like, hey!
Five easy ones, come on.
Darren Brown, David Blaine, Guy Hollingworth. Do they have to all be alive?
Penn and Teller. Oh, Ricky.
Yeah,
Ricky J.
Yeah, Ricky J. Nate Leipzig. Then, if I'm allowed to have.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's fine. Yeah. So, and the one.
I didn't really. Oh, I know. No, Chris Angel. Chris Angel. Ooh. Even more. Chris Angel.
Is that all right, Rob? Is that
any other questions in the room or in Zoom? Oh, the actors. Okay. Five I don't like.
Now this is the the teaser trailer for the whole video. This bit right here. Okay, go.
Yeah. Okay. So straight away. So it's from my Coronation Street days. And he was a guy called Chris Quentin. I did a show called Ultraviolet, had a small part. It was a bigger part. It got cut, which pisses me off. Part of the reason it got cut, I think, is because the guy who's the lead, Jack Davenport,
Idris Elba was there as well.
Idris Elba, love Idris Elba. I had birthday cake with Idris Elba. I had some of Idris Elba's birthday cake with him on his birthday in the green room, and we sat chatting about, he was into music, that's what I really remember. He talked about his music a lot, and lovely guy, and very happy he's very successful. Lovely. Jack Davenport, no. So I sit down, you sit down on a set. You sit down and you go, hi, you know, go, hello. So we've got this scene. Do you mind running the lines? Yeah, let's do that. I sit down and I turn to him. He immediately goes like this and starts talking to whoever, the lighting guy, I don't know. And so I'm like, oh, okay, I'll wait for him to finish. The lighting and everything else. And I'm thinking at some point he's going to turn around and go, hi, I'm Jack. Nothing at all. Literally nothing. Just ignores me the whole time. Eventually, just before they're about to, I go, okay, hi, I'm Colin. And he goes, oh, yeah, Jack. And that's it. That's literally all he did. Then we do the scene where we're supposed to be like good friends. So I'm thinking, we haven't really got that rapport going on here, which I was hoping to build. And we did a few scenes like that. And I just had a feeling, I don't know why, I don't think he didn't like me. So then as I'm going home, you get picked up in a car, and I was getting so you get given, the chauffeur takes you home, and you're like, oh, fantastic. As I'm getting in the car, a runner comes over to the car and goes, would you mind giving Jack a lift home, because it's on the way? And I was like, yeah, it's not for me to say. Yeah, of course. Yeah, no problem. So anyway, so she says, would you mind sitting in the back? Okay. So I have to get out of the front seat into the back. He gets in the front, spends the entire journey not talking to me, literally says nothing to me at all. And the thing that really pissed me off, we went past my house to go to his, that was like about 3 miles further on. And then he gets out and just says, cheers to the driver, completely ignores me. And then the driver goes, yeah, you get some like that. I'll take you back now. So yeah, Jack Davenport, Chris Quentin. Do you know why this is quite, it is quite hard, and why those two stick in my head? It's because actually on the whole, almost every actor I've ever worked with has been lovely. And that's one of the best things about the profession. Yeah. Someone I really like. Oh, Paul Nicholas. Paul Nicholas. But Bill Nighy did a radio play. No, Bill Nighy, very lovely. Yeah, no, Bill Nighy, very lovely. Except, no, it's tiny. And it's, so I worked a lot in radio, and one of the things I was good at was accents. I know you wouldn't know it from all the stuff you've seen me do, but I was. So I was casting the daughter-in-law, which is a Nottinghamshire piece, and Nottinghamshire is a very difficult accent to master. There's a five-hander, me, Bill Nighy, Samantha Bond, Anne Wright, and Avril Ogar. I remember that from years. Well, we were nominated for a Sony, just saying, best drama. Anyway, so we do this, and I get sent the script, and the director goes, I know you're very good at accents. Nottinghamshire, are you okay with this? Send me the tapes, I'll learn it. Went back in on the first day of rehearsal. He goes, so, what do you think about the accent? And I went, yeah, it's okay. I think I've got it. I've worked at it. And yeah, I've got it down, I think. It's okay, yeah. And he went, I'm just doing General Northern. I was like, okay. So we do the read through all the way through. The director has to come up to me at the end. He goes, Colin, I can totally see the work you've done, but you're the only person doing a Nottinghamshire accent. Can you just do General Northern like everybody else? Yeah, okay. Yeah, I can do that. So there you go. That's the only thing. And but actually he was really lovely. I mean, genuinely lovely. We spent like a week doing like a proper play. Utterly lovely. I think that's enough from me. Anybody on Zoom? What actor? Tom, are you still there?
I love Jack Davenport.
So, yeah.
What?
He's really nice to me. I had a great time with him. Yeah, yeah, really, really genuinely nice, you know, to everyone. He even stopped and gave some homeless guy some money, you know. It was really, like, lovely, lovely human
being. And he always speaks to the lighting guys and
yeah.
the sparks.
You know, all the crew, inclusive. Yeah. Couldn't agree more.
Jen, save us.
No. So the quiz. Here we go. First question, first round.
I have a magic
Actually,
question.
I can't hear. There's a bloody quiz they're organising, a Star Trek quiz in another room. I was like, I'm a bit conflicted about that, I have to
say. Take us with you.
So Mal, what else can we do? Sorry.
Jen would like to ask a question. She's been trying for a while.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's a magic question. So this will be for Pete.
Not necessarily.
It is for you. Sorry. So other than the trick that you had to learn with a bottle cap across the fingertips, what was the most frustrating trick to try and learn? Like the one that took the longest to perfect?
I can show you one of the things that took the longest to learn. Hang on. Here we go. This is So can you see that? Pack of cards. Trying to keep this in view, but it was that, which is a one-handed riffle shuffle. Ooh. Yeah. One-handed riffle shuffle. That took quite a while. As I've got older, my hands have got drier. And the friction isn't there to do the moves in the same way as when I was in my 20s and 30s. So it's, it's now whether I've got the motivation and need to be able to learn a new way of doing a secondary. I haven't even found one. I haven't found a new way of doing it because my hands have got dry and changed as I've got older. Doesn't do the move in the same way. So that's now taking quite a while to try and relearn that and find a new way of doing it. The one-handed riffle shuffle, that took quite a while.
Thank you.
That's all right. Thank you.
We have a lot of people in the chat saying, I can't even shuffle with two hands. That's cool. Do you have to do any sort of exercises to keep your hands limber?
Yeah. I do. Here we go. So there's various ones you can do. You can do finger shuffling, which is where you start with your hands that way, and then you change one hand, change two, change three, change four, and then change them back again, like that. So that's good for piano as well. Doing the that sort of thing, and then there's is this sort of thing where you do. You see that, which is. Little exercise. I play piano as well and guitar, and that sort of keeps my fingers nimble. So any more questions on Zoom or in the room? Oh, Rob's got one. He's gone.
So as you got your cards out, about you were actually on our club exactly 1 year ago today, and you did a group magic trick with us, if you remember.
I do.
And I just wondered if you might be able to, A, show that trick again for everyone who hasn't seen it before or can't remember it, but then you also... You also, when I said that there was a variation on that trick, you weren't aware of that. And I wondered if I could show you that afterwards.
Has anyone got a pack of cards on Zoom?
Jen does. Jen's grabbing a set.
I can't remember how I got to that, because I came up with a really nice way of starting it. I'm just going to keep talking over this, because there's magic speak going on. They're explaining a trick to each other. It's quite exciting at the moment. People are enwrapped.
Oh, yeah, Jen.
Can you pin them? Can someone pin them or something? Hey!
Hi, Jen.
Hi.
So Jen, shuffle the cards. Shuffle the cards you've got. Yep. Have you got a flat surface or a table in front of you?
Yeah.
Lovely, lovely. So if you, are you happy they're shuffled?
Yep, yep. Getting rid of jokers?
Yeah, take the jokers out.
Okay.
Get rid of the jokers.
Okay. All right, they're shuffled. Yep.
Excellent, excellent. What I want you to do then is just deal out three piles of three cards.
Okay.
In front of you. So there's three piles of three cards. Perfect. Oh, yes, there we go. One, two. Then put the rest of the pile, rest of the cards to one side for a moment. Excellent, excellent. Now, what I want you to do is pick up any one of those three piles. And then mix them up until you have satisfied they're mixed. And now just tilt them to you, tilt them to yourself so you can see the card, the card that you've shuffled to. So you've got the card at the bottom. You've seen that?
Yeah.
So you know the bottom card of that pile, yes?
Yes.
Excellent. Dump that on top of one of the other piles. Yep. And then pick up the whole lot. Pick up the whole middle pile again and just dump them on top of the others.
Okay.
Lovely. And pick up those.
Uh-huh.
Now so you're the only person who knows what that card is at the moment, yes?
Uh-huh.
So I want you to spell out the name of the card silently to yourself, but dealing a card down for each letter. So if it was an ace, it would go A, C, E. Okay?
Okay.
From the top. Face down onto whatever, spell out the name of your card. The beginning, first part of it.
Okay.
Okay, and then dump all the rest of the cards on the top of the ones you've just dealt. Yep, pick them all up. Now the next word is of, because all cards are something of something. So deal OF. And then dump the others on top. Dump all the rest of the top on top. Yep. Oh, it's terrifying. It's terrifying here. Pick all of those up. Pick all of those up. And then spell out the suit of the card as well. One, dealing one card down for each letter of the suit. How many cards? There we go. There we go. There we go. There we go. I was just going, Okay, and then put the rest on top. Now we want to pick them all up again. So you're the only person who knows what the card was, yes?
Uh-huh. Yep.
And you've spelt it out. This time we're going to do a bit of magic. So what I'd like to do is just spell out the word magic. So one card for each letter. So M.
Okay.
Yeah. Then A.
Uh-huh.
Next card. G.
Uh-huh.
I.
Uh-huh.
C.
Uh-huh.
And put all the rest of the cards in your hand off to one side. Perfect. The top, put your hand on the top card of the last card you dealt down. Yes. And now tell us the name of your card.
Five of clubs.
The five of club. Turn over that card. Turn over that card. Yay! Magic.
Thank you. Now stop spotlighting me, please.
The five of club. Wonderful.
Excellent. So pick any nine cards you like. Okay, give them a really good shuffle again if you want to.
Oh, I haven't
got it. Okay, so if you put them now into three piles of three, as Jen did, look at the bottom card. If you've remembered that card and then put it on top of the other two piles, what I'd like you to do is come up with your best lie. Yeah, so what you're going to tell us the card is?
Jack Diamonds.
Okay, so if you spell out Jack.
J-A-C-K.
Put the cards on top. Now spell out of.
O-F.
And on top again. Now spell out diamonds.
D-I-A-M-O-N-D-S.
And then put that one on top. Okay. Yep. But But this time, because the cards know whether you're telling the truth or lying, you need to tell them that you were lying this time. So if you put down four more cards for lied.
L-I-E-D, I lied.
Okay. Now, tell everyone now for the first time, what was your actual card?
The actual card was the 10 of spades.
Okay. Try turning over that last card, and I hope it works.
I think you just made Pete a believer, Rob.
Yeah. Oh, the five of club. The five of club. You're never leaving that turn, Jen.
So what's next, Mel?
We want to see who all is in the room.
So we have Rob.
And Colin.
So hang on, so you're over there. Hang on. Oh, where are we? Oh, we're there. Yeah, so we have that. So that's the bit you're seeing over there. And then around this side, I can't get much further, a bit closer, unfortunately. Hello, everybody. It's massive, actually. And it's really lovely, I have to say. It's really lovely. Oh, hello. Hello, look. Hello. Yeah. I've got to wave again. Oh, yeah. And then there's people over there. Oh, we haven't. Have we shown them the cakes yet? No. Have you seen the cakes? Oh, there goes Amy. Amy's going for the cakes. Oh, yeah, we're going to eat one on camera. So Tom wants to see this eaten in slow motion. Oh, look at Tom's back. Tom is eager. Here we go. Look, are you ready? Okay, so look. They are genuine. So Rob had them for his 40th birthday. And Mallory very kindly bought, 36, all different flavours, all very lovely. And I had to go and pick them up on the way down here. But they are massive, beautiful cupcakes. Dr. Bashir birthday cupcakes. Look at that. Look at his little face. Oh, eat it. Come on, Amy. Go on, pick one and eat it. Come on. Put them down. Pick one and eat it. In slow motion. Yeah, here we go. Get in closer. Come on, closer. Go. So yeah.
The money for those cupcakes has all gone to cancer research as well.
Awesome.
Oh,
Colin, your camera work needs polishing.
What? What do you mean? So still no Sid. Tell him I'm disappointed.
No.
What the hell?
We were also going to have Andy joining us, but he is exhausted and has a big weekend ahead, so he is not there tonight.
But he will be on the panel.
Let's talk about the panel tomorrow.
Yeah, so actually, who here is going tomorrow? Just out of interest. Wow, okay.
Every hand better be up.
That's a lot of people going. That is a lot of people. Oh, yeah, it's 9:30 in the morning that we're doing the panel. This is going to go on a bit longer tonight, I feel. And there's quite a few drinks to be had still. Yeah, so we're doing the panel. But yeah, it's the story of Sid City and how he got people through the pandemic. And Rob's going to be on there. He's going to be, and Rob, I have to say, he's been an absolute star. He got us the contact with Destination Star Trek, made this happen. And he's going to be telling his story, which I don't know if you've shared with a lot of people. So it's going to be, yeah, it's genuinely amazing, actually. Mallory's coming on. She's going to do a mini presentation of the findings about the Sid City Social Club, as well as sharing her story about how she ended up at Sid City, which is also very interesting and quite moving. And then Andy and Nana are going to be there. I've pre-recorded the questions with Sid. There's also a surprise video that I've recorded with someone. Yeah, so I'm not saying it. It's terrible. I normally blurt it out who it is, but I'm not going to.
Jack Davenport. Very lovely.
Wow, if he's there tomorrow, that would be hilarious. Wow. Yeah, so we're doing the panel, and I think it's really lovely because, yeah, I mean, if you'd have said just over a year ago that I would be here doing this with one of my best mates, having one of my best mates not appearing on Zoom, I would have said that's probably what's going to happen. But
thanks, Colin. But
yeah, I know. Yeah, I'm glad you're representing at least. Yeah, so it's the story of how Sid City got people through the pandemic. And I have taken a leaf out of Pete's book. So normally when I see a panel randomly asking questions like, you know, what did you do in episode 6 when you fired the phaser that way, when that doesn't work? And so what I've tried to do is tell a narrative of how the panel, how it came about, what happened to people, what was good, what was lovely about it, and where it's going. I'm really proud of it, actually. I'm really proud that I get the chance to do this. I'm really proud of doing it with Rob and Mallory. I hope it's going to be good. I always think, as a performer, when I watch the hosts at these comic cons and what have you, I always think, they always just like, they turn up in like jeans and a t-shirt and like have a piece of paper that they read the questions from all the time. And I'm like, put that paper down. Talk to the guys on the stage with you. Just ask, just talk to them. You know, just do that. And it really bugs me. So I said to Mel, I'm gonna wear a suit tomorrow. However, Mel said, are you gonna wear a tux? I was like, no, I'm not gonna go that far. No, I'm just gonna wear a suit. However, after going shopping yesterday and today to about 7 different stores, how hard would it be to buy a suit, you think? Could I buy one? No. Could I find one? No. So today I ended up going to Marks and Spencer's, and the only suit they had in my size is a dress suit, a dinner jacket with the flashy lapels and the trousers that have the line down the side. So I'm wearing a very posh suit tomorrow. And a new pair of shoes, but I am wearing, to juxtapose that, I'm wearing my Quizmaster splattered paint shirt underneath. Yeah. So that's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm wearing. Look at that face. So that's what I'm going to wear. But it will look smart and quirky at the same time, which is nothing like me. So that's good.
I'd like to hear from Mallory about this.
Well, I haven't seen it yet. The stripe down the side really kind of threw me off.
Is it a neon green stripe?
No, it's not. No, it's not. So we'll both be a surprise. I had to shop for my clothes today too, because my clothes are all still in the US, apparently, somewhere. Atlanta, maybe Minneapolis. We don't really know where they ended up. So we'll both be wearing our brand new outfits tomorrow.
And can I tell them about the necklace? So of all the things that could have ended up in her bags didn't arrive today. So the reason Mallory joined Sid City was because when she was a child, she used to watch Star Trek with her dad. And he passed away in September last year. And she started watching Star Trek again, his memory. And then because of that, Facebook was listening and Sid City popped up and she goes, oh, this is interesting.
It was one of those necklaces that, so like when someone passes away and you're ordering the urn and everything, when they're cremated, you can get jewelry. And at first I thought that was super, super creepy, like to wear, I just thought it was really weird. But then when I found out I was doing this panel, I was like, how cool would it be to bring a piece of my dad with me? So I bought one of those necklaces, put a little bit of him in there before I spread him in the river. But now the necklace is in Atlanta or Minneapolis or somewhere. We don't really know.
So Dad would have been on the panel with us. Probably not a lot of time for questions, the way that it's going. Because when I interviewed Sid, I was trying to get him to give me 30-second answers. How hard is that? So the answers that he gives are... and they're really touching, actually. They're really, yeah, really lovely, actually. I think you'll really like it. So Sid's going to be there in spirit and on camera. Mel is going to be there in spirit and in camera. And Nana and Andy on stage. Me, Mallory and Rob. So, yeah. And thank you, everybody, for... who's ever come to my quizzes in the last year or so, and even those who haven't, for whatever reason, for making it a massive part of my life, actually, a huge part of my life. And that was what was really interesting when I was chatting to Sid about and asking him the questions, how we were just sharing that moment of how it's impacted both of us, actually. And I have to say, possibly the biggest impact is sat right next to me on the right here. yeah, because I've met Mallory through it. Oh, my God. That's not amazing. Anyway, I'll shut up now.
We didn't really get to interact with anyone else in the room.
Three people sit on the couch and take over. Come on.
Tell us about meeting in person for the first time.
Yes. Come on. There we go. There you go. Come on.
Okay. Hi, Mel.
Hey, Marla. Hey, Marla.
Do I have to?
Tanya, wow, you made it. Awesome.
Well, it's nice to finally see people that we are used to seeing over the screen, and now I can hug them. Hi.
I haven't said hello yet. I was late. I arrived late. I'm really sorry. I haven't actually said hi to anyone. Hi, come here. Okay, that was it. That was it for me.
That's great. I mean, if we just want to have a stream of people doing that.
Cool, all right.
That's fine. No, Tanya's got something to say.
So I arrived this morning, and I have been pitching my arm all day long. This is real.
Aw. Oh, great. The glizzard.
Oh, it be. I left the house in drag.
Yay!
The first time ever. And somehow this is still on my face, which is a miracle.
It looks amazing.
Thank you. I feel very self-conscious now.
But you look great.
Thank you. I hung out with Sophie a lot and talked in great detail about the entirety of our lives, and then came here and hugged people, and it was lovely.
Nice to join you.
Hello.
Yay.
We did lots of oversharing today.
We
it was
did,
wonderful.
Rather. What am I doing with my hands? Sorry, I have no had idea. Alcohol, and my tolerance is none now.
Some alcohol holes have been had.
So, Jadita, I hear you're working at the moment. No, Sid's schedule wasn't the only thing that got a bit mix and match today, but it was actually a massive miracle for me, because we wrapped early from a little production called Captain Marvel 2. And that is the reason why I'm here, meeting my friends for the first time.
Yay! I mean,
me and Emma, we live in the same city. And then here we are. Isn't it beautiful?
It is beautiful. I love it.
I got to London on the 5th, and I've met Sophie, Emma, and Emma throughout the week, and it's been amazing. And I've now met about 10 people from Sid City Social Club, so please beat my record. Actually, from now, it's much higher, so go for it. But it's been really fun to be here and just to hang out with everybody outside of this, and now I'll see everybody here too.
Oh, Colin, what's General Northern? Please.
You know, it's people talk like that. It's just do General Northern, Oh, no, I'm on my own again. Come on, hang on. Oh, yes. Come on. Oh, yes. Come on, this is a brilliant.
People who know of my love/worship of all things Andy Robinson know that I have met him for the first time in Zoom in August last year. And it was very emotional.
There were tears involved.
Many, many tears, including Mel's tears, which I did not expect. Which is very sweet.
I thought I was on mute in my defense.
We all saw the tissue. And I told Andy that I wrote a sequel to A Stitch in Time because I was inspired by the book. It saved me from a very dark place, dragged me out of a very deep depression. And I told myself, if I ever went to a convention, which was very unlikely because I lived in Croatia and traveling anywhere is prohibitively expensive, and I thought it would never happen, but I told myself I would give him the book if I ever
So the props have arrived. And I was like, okay. But I gave him the digital version of the book. And he was gracious enough to accept it. But this culprit here.
It was my fault.
Blame Karen. Congratulate her. She has graciously decided to invest a lot of her time, like a ridiculous amount of time and planning, to typeset Under the Blind Moon and make it into a book. And Judita should be here. Judita should be here.
Yeah, you designed the cover.
Because Judita designed the cover.
That's amazing.
And it's very nice. Wow. 677
pages.
This is a...
That's a novel.
Yeah, I'll probably get it to Andy tomorrow sometime.
Hopefully.
Yeah. The books, anybody who wants them can order one. And we have a whole box full of them, so...
That is awesome. Congratulations on having a piece of your work that you can hold in your hand as a book. Yes. Karen, that was lovely.
It was absolutely my pleasure. I thought I wanted to give something back because the story...
And yes. Jennifer, who edited a huge chunk of it. So, credit where credit is due. But yes, it's real.
That's amazing.
And now I'm going to bugger off to somebody else. Yes.
Congratulations, Arena.
Yeah, I have the feeling that this will be a bit unhinged today as well.
What, because of me?
Why not?
Yay! It's Hello. Two Collins in the same place.
Yes. It's the mirror universe one and the real one.
Prime Colin.
I'm kind of nervous suddenly in front of cameras, so I'm gonna just let you say.
Oh, bless you. Okay, actually, I'm gonna ask you a question. It's about Sid City Social Club.
Yeah.
So for you, what is your fondest memory of Sid City Social Club?
My fondest memory? It might be tonight, actually, because everyone has just gelled in real life as much as they do. And I'm not, you know, I'm not on the Discord all the time, or I'm not necessarily on all the calls, but just seeing everyone is just thrilling, because everyone has really, and all the different ways that people have survived this pandemic has been a lot down to yourself, Mel, to yourself, Colin, to Rob, to everyone, just really making this happen. It really has helped me. And also, I think the other fondest memory I'm going to have is tomorrow at 9:30.
Yeah, who's going to top that one? Fondest memory of Sid City Social Club. Anybody? Amy?
Was it eating Sid's face on camera? Was that it?
Number one favorite memory. Yeah, no. My favorite memory was actually, it was election night of 2020 and in the U.S. when Amy Doodles came on and shared us her amazing costume. And just completely lighten the mood for a very, very tense America. And I just remember just crying, laughing that night. And it was possibly just like exactly what I needed in a way that I didn't know that I needed it. That was probably my favorite memory.
Nice. That's a good one.
I mean, we had pretty positive news, medical news from people in the club.
Oh, yes.
I think, honestly, that was a huge, powerful moment for everybody. Honestly, the best memories are always like when people started to interact with each other, ignoring Sid. That is like,
No, that's because that's when you know it's become a real community, right?
Exactly. Like people referring, oh, yeah, but you remember 2 weeks ago, this other person, oh, here you are, random person that I never met, but now you're my best friend. And like, Sid is there like, okay. I love those moments a lot.
Yeah, I My other favorite memory is the day that Yanina shared her medical news.
Yeah, exactly.
I was just weeping because I had gotten to know her on post quiz, thanks to this guy here. And just been talking to her on weekends and stuff every night. And just when I found out that news, knowing it had been weighing on her for so long, I just lost it. I think I emailed Malcolm and signed up tonight. I was like, take me off the list. I can't talk tonight. Because I was just weeping. And everyone's like, oh, in the chat, like, Amy's crying. And I'm like, I was just so relieved for her. And that's when I kind of realized, like, no, I really care about these people in this group. It wasn't just, oh, these people on the internet, screen names or whatever. It was just like, I deeply was relieved for Yanina, my new friend, who I wish were here tonight. Yes. So close, but so far. And yeah, just every night that I stay up until like 4 a.m. talking, because this guy is post quiz. I know, you. Just the craziness of that. It was another venue of just getting to know people on a personal level, completely removed from Sid. And how amazing that was, just get to know the other people in this group. And it's made this all better, especially like meeting people in this group. And I mean, Sophie and I met for the first time on Sunday, and we just like great. Like everybody that I've met from post quiz that I've talked to on post quiz is just like, no, these are friends. These are like full stop, just friends. And it's been great. Thanks, Paul.
Oh, it's a pleasure. And not just the fact I had a Zoom that was pro. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's all it was. Yeah, I'm leaving. I'm going to bed now.
Yes, the traffic light system for the stickers. Rob came up with that. So there's a green sticker, a yellow sticker, and a red sticker. Green means hugs are great. Elbow bumps for yellow stickers. No touching for red stickers.
And also very useful for going up to the bar and ordering, because then they know you're with us because you're wearing a sticker, you see. Not some rando Star Trek nerd out there. There's a lot of them. Just going, hang on, they're ordering and not paying. I'll try that. No, got a sticker, mate, not working. Even if you do look like an Andorian, like that guy over there. Amy is going to the bar with her phone to take a photo of the Andorian in boxer shorts. Just for you. Let's see on this. Can you pin Amy? Can you pin Amy for a spell?
Let me find her again.
Yeah, she's one. Oh, there we go.
Yep. The nose there is part of the respiratory system. Yay! There we go!
Yay! Yay! Yes.
And Dorian on vacation.
Yes, wearing boxer shorts. Wow. So, Mel, question for you.
Yes.
It's tough. What is your single fondest memory of Sid City Social Club?
When he figured out who the people in the restaurant were on his birthday.
Oh, yes. Yes. Yeah. Oh, it's you! It's
you!
Oh
my goodness! Oh my goodness! You guys, I have to tell you who this is.
It's true. It's true. And also the fact when Lord British came on, he was obviously going, who the hell's this?
I know.
And then it was like, oh, what? Oh, my childhood. It was lovely.
Honestly was concerned that he was going to have a stroke because there was no time in between each guest. Like it just went because everybody was on a really tight schedule. And I was like, oh my gosh, I hope his heart's okay. I hope we're going to be okay with this. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that might be one of mine as well, actually. Yeah.
I broke him.
Yeah, that was pretty special, that was.
All right, well, folks, thank you all for joining us. I think I will leave the Zoom room open. I think I'll make the London folks the host. So if you guys want to hang out and interact with people in the room and on Zoom, you are welcome to.
Okay. See you later, Mel.
Bye. Thanks, everybody. And don't forget, if you're in London, panel tomorrow at 9:30 on the Voyager stage. Bye, everybody. Have so much fun.
See you later. See you later, Mel. Bye. Bye.